Data is exhausting. We are trapped in endless cycles of data preparation and crazy expectations. This relentless era of technological transformation is draining morale even faster than it drains our resources, and we're struggling with growing complexity and maybe even growing doubts about our ability to deliver.
Data is scary. Garbage in, garbage out isn't the worst thing in the world, but putting trust in that garbage is. Misplaced trust in data for AI has led to an accumulation of issues, and the bill is coming due.
So in the face of all this, we have one question for you. Are you okay?
You know, we ask because we hear you say things in inquiries, and we see alarming indicators in our surveys. Anxiety and fatigue are setting in. Since Gen AI went mainstream, you've been told to deliver AI data, ensure ROI, optimize data-driven culture, and achieve the impossible swiftly.
AI is impacting everything, and the hype is undeniable. Every vendor has added AI to their product, creating an abundance of choices with similar promises. AI washing poses a risk to our initiatives by overpromising and underdelivering. You may not be responsible for AI, often that is the CIO, but we all have an important role to play. So yeah, you're exhausted. Yeah, you're scared, but this is the best time to be in data and analytics.
Boy, is it ever, is it ever. As you look to scale data and analytics, it might feel like a mad dash to the finish line, but it's not. AI is not a one-off implementation. It's a continuous transformation. In that sense, it has a lot of similarities with the race to the moon, because you know, that was never about putting a man on the moon. Instead, it was transformative for Earth. It fundamentally changed technology and science, and it's still impacting us today, sometimes in ways we don't even realize. For example, it gave us satellites, GPS, and smaller electronic circuits. And that memory foam in your mattress? Yep, it gave us that too. And just like the space race is still transforming us today, AI will continue to transform data and analytics in obvious and not so obvious ways. We've had less than 3 years since Gen AI went mainstream and ChatGPT became a household brand. More than half the CEOs believe AI is the technology that will most significantly impact their industry over the next 3 years. But bringing AI to life is not just about the technology. It's about the discoveries we make and the new problems we solve.
This isn't a race, it's a transformation. You must scale data and analytics on your AI journeys, adapting continuously to new and changing terrain without a detailed roadmap.
Let's start with the journey to business outcomes. About half of you struggle to demonstrate the value of your initiatives. Is it you? Maybe it's a person sitting next to you. Why is it so hard to demonstrate the value of data analytics and AI? Trust. The world is asking, should we trust AI? Or even more nerve-wracking, when should we trust AI and when should we approach it with caution? We've all been primed by Hollywood to fear AI. Which movie does your mind go to? For me, it's the Terminator. There's something about that menacing relentlessness that really scares me. Or maybe it's just Arnold Schwarzenegger in those sunglasses. It is not just AI that people don't trust. They often don't trust the data that fuels it. Data quality, lineage, bias, complexity, and that's just the tip of the iceberg. In our recent AI survey, we found that data availability or data quality is the number one obstacle when implementing AI. If our organizations don't trust AI and they don't trust the data, how can they trust the outcomes? Trust determines if you will succeed or fail. In order to get to business outcomes, we need to help our organizations to move from can we trust data and AI to how can we make data and AI more trustworthy? To build trust in data, we need governance. But you know what? We've never been good at that. And now AI demands that we be great. But we have to accept two things. Number one, data will never be fully governed. And number two, attempting to fully govern data before delivering AI is just not realistic. So we need more practical solutions. Trust models. Now, trust models provide a trust rating to data by looking at value, lineage, and risk. They offer up-to-date information on data trustworthiness. You need to implement trust models to help understand the right trust level based on context. They're critical for fostering confidence, and they let us set the strictness of governance for a given context. Now, I know trust models sound like a lot of work. They are. But they're absolutely worth it. Our research shows that organizations that have implemented trust models achieve higher levels of efficiency, risk mitigation, and value creation. But how do you get started? Well, first, you need to get crystal clear on your business goals and use cases. Next, look at your data and pay attention to lineage and curation. Then assign the appropriate trust ratings. Now, Alda Mazaku is the Chief Data and Analytics Officer at Children's National Hospital in Washington, D.C. She knew that creating value and trusting data go hand in hand. So to improve the usage, she developed a system to rate their data assets. This allows users to quickly understand what levels of trust are associated with a specific data set. By understanding the trust levels, the risk of doctors and nurses using incorrect data has been significantly reduced, which means that sick kids are getting even better care. Now that's real value.
Now, if AI is the frosted deliciousness that we want to eat, governance is the kale salad.
Hey, wait a minute. I love kale salad.
Okay. So, yeah, just like kale salad is essential in a balanced diet, everybody intellectually understands the importance of governance. But governance might feel like it's slowing you down. But have you thought about how governance and innovation go hand in hand to allow you to speed things up? Maybe I can have my AI cake and eat it too. When AI forces you to accelerate, you need to take more risks, and that means sometimes you will fail. Now, maybe it's a little cliche, but fail should be just a first attempt in learning. That's why we establish innovation labs. They're a safe place to fail and therefore learn. By developing prototypes in weeks instead of months, you can test ideas faster, get feedback earlier, and learn sooner. Now, Roger Federer once said that perfection is impossible, and he won only 54% of his points. But more importantly, he won almost 80% of his games. In other words, even the most successful tennis players barely win more than half the points, but they and you can still win the game. Let's translate this approach from the tennis court to the assembly line. Thierry Martin, the head of data and analytics at Toyota Motor Europe, established trust-based governance that he calls freedom in a box. Instead of a governance culture that says no, they have a governance culture that says yes. They provide boundaries instead of restrictions. They empower business teams to build their own data products as long as certain requirements are met around value, platform, governance, compliance, and security. Freedom to fail but with the guardrails to prevent catastrophe. That is the hallmark of a trust-based governance culture. So now that we've worked through some of our trust issues, you still need to think about dealing with your money problems. Measuring the value of data and analytics is not new. You still need to do the basics. But what we measure, how often we measure, and how we measure has to change. Financial metrics like cost reduction, always the safe bet for impact. But don't forget the non-financial metrics. Customer satisfaction, public opinion, employee well-being. They all matter to key stakeholders in your organization and should be part of the story you tell to win their support. Let's go back to Thierry, the leader at Toyota. He understands the importance of making and demonstrating an impact. So rather than just monitoring the progress of the projects that he's working on, he tracks their value. And to do this, he established a role he called the DNA translator. That person works closely with the business units. The translator measures the contribution of data and analytics and ensures the recognition of its impact on metrics such as cost, efficiency, and value generation.
Yeah, and here's another example about value creation in the age of AI. Goldman Sachs CEO David Solomon recently said that AI can draft 90%, 95% of an IPO prospectus in minutes. Now, that efficiency gain is notable, especially considering that it used to take a six-person team 2 weeks to do that same task. AI will make us more productive. The Dutch software company AFAS recognized that the productivity of their employees had increased 650% over the past 25 years, and recent advances in AI and automation further accelerated this. As a result, they decided to move from a 5-day work week to a 4-day work week, but keeping all the same benefits, such as salary and pension. Now, what will you do with this productivity improvement? Personally, I think I'm going to spend more time in my garden. Gen AI changes how people work. Traditional AI techniques often automate tasks, but now you need to think differently about productivity gains. Here's why. Depending on the complexity of the task and the experience level of the role, there are different zones of productivity. For example, when Gen AI helps you with coding, senior developers will benefit more from it. Their role is complex and their experience level is high. They know what good looks like and they land in the zone of deep productivity. While junior developers also have a complex role, they have lower experience. For them, the benefit lies in quicker onboarding and upskilling. They get productivity benefits, but it's off the zone of deep productivity. Whenever you use coding or other productivity assistance, there will be a return on employee. You can apply this to any data and analytics role, but that's only one type of value. When you're prototyping use cases, there will be different value outcomes, as well as cost and risk implications. If you can tie a use case to an improved process or decision, that will be a return on investment. And if you're making investments that can change the game with new products or markets, that'll be a return on the future. These three types of value are great, but you know, we can't talk about value without talking about cost. There's a level of uncertainty when it comes to cost. Recent advances, such as DeepSeek, promise a game-changing reduction in costs. The good news is that valuable AI is getting cheaper and more attainable. But just as we saw with the cloud, these cost reductions may actually lead to increased total expenditure and cost of ownership. Organizations get more bang for their buck, but they end up spending far more than they originally planned. IT and business budgeting needs to reform and accelerate if they want to manage this uncertainty and surf the AI wave without crashing. Some costs, are obvious, right? Like salaries and user licenses. But to truly identify financially viable use cases, you must factor in all costs, including data management, governance, and even change management.
Knowing the metrics of cost and value is only going to help us if the business understands why it's important to them. In our surveys, you told us the business does not understand data and analytics. The best way to solve this is to get better at storytelling. Which brings us to Keith Krutt. He is the manager of analytics at the National Gallery of Art in Washington, D.C. Now, Keith uses the art and the museum itself to create a data story experience. He takes his leadership team on a tour of the museum and shows how anonymous visitor data is used to understand which art should be more prominently featured and how to optimize foot traffic. Once his team understands how data can support decision-making, they can apply it all over their organization. Now, storytelling is about bridging the gap between the numbers and the business impact by combining math and storytelling and salesmanship. So first, the math. Link the insights, patterns, and trends to the metrics that your organization cares about. Second, the storytelling. Make insights stick by crafting a memorable narrative and bring the story to life with real examples that will actually connect with your audience. And third, salesmanship. Frame data in a way that highlights potential benefits and better business outcomes. This will foster a mutually beneficial relationship and keep them coming back for more. Britta Andercheck is the CDO for the City of Dallas. She defines success as her business partners thinking of her team as part of their team. Her team's close partnership with the Office of Emergency Management was crucial last year when the storms created power outages throughout the city. Their work reduced the city's response time by 85% when compared to previous emergencies. It resulted in resources, emergency responders, and recovery efforts being deployed to those areas with the greatest need. So her math, 85% reduction in response time. Her storytelling, data keeps the people of the City of Dallas safe. And her salesmanship, close partnership with those key decision makers. So we told you that it's vital to prioritize trust to scale your initiatives and get to those business outcomes. Start with establishing trust models and trust-based governance that allows you to understand the reliability and integrity of your data and helps you accelerate prototyping. Use your productivity improvements to create three areas of value with a return on employee, a return on investment, and a return on the future. And finally, storytelling is essential to communicate the value of what we do and build those collaborative relationships. Because it's not the organization that provides the most dashboards, the most data sets or reports that creates the most value. The organizations that deliver and thrive will be the ones that run on trust and communicate the value of having made those right investments.